Good morning and welcome to our online service. It's great to see you today and to share in this act of worship. Today we celebrate the goodness of God and we begin a new sermon series, Sold Out for God, and Ben Evans, our curate, is going to be speaking the first of the sermons on the theme of being a family, God's family. A key verse today is from Acts chapter 2 and verses 46 and 47. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. In a moment, we're going to worship together. But first of all, let me say thank you to all those who have contributed to our worship, all those who have sung, all those who played instruments. You really have been fabulous. Thank you. Now, during this week, I've been hearing testimonies of how God has used these online worship times. And some people have shared how when it comes to the worship, they've sung at the top of their voices. Others have stood to worship God in their lounges or kitchens or wherever they are. And others might have knelt or may have quietly sung in their own hearts. There is no right way to worship God, but there is an invitation to enter his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. So now, let's worship God together.
Forever, sing praise.
Wow, hasn't it been amazing to worship together in this way this morning? Thank you so much to our worship teams. Now we have our reading, which is brought to us by the amazing Suma Gahi, and our talk for today on the passage that Sue is about to read from Acts, and on the theme of God's family, brought to us by Ben Evans. And isn't he amazing? And thank you to both of them for all they've been doing during this COVID season. We really appreciate you both. Thank you.
The reading is taken from Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47. The believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute to any who had need. Day by day, they spent much time together in the temple. They broke bread and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. Day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved.
Well, lockdown has been easing up a bit in recent weeks, hasn't it? So let me ask the big, obvious question, how does that make you feel? Personally, I'm feeling a bit mixed, if I'm honest. On the one hand, I'm itching to get out and see people. Elise and I had a good meal with some great friends last week, and it was wonderful just to feel normal again. But on the other hand, sometimes I feel just that little bit apprehensive. I think to myself, are the shops being as diligent as they should be with all the cleaning? Will other people respect the social distancing and the mask wearing that we're meant to be doing? Perhaps you share these feelings. I know, for example, that schools are reopening again, and this week must have been such a big one for young people in our community. Especially for their parents as well. Did you feel relief? Anxiety maybe? What if you're in the most at-risk categories? How are you reacting to the restrictions loosening? What about you who live alone? Has it been a relief perhaps to see more friends and family? Or have you come out of lockdown with a real sense of trepidation at being out and about again? And how might we seek help from God in this new phase? In a time perhaps of desiring to be out and about, but anxious about other people's behaviour. A time perhaps of longing to go back to normal, but of fearing the consequences. How can we seek God's help? Well, the first and most blatant observation that I want to make from our passage is that these Christians were together. Verse 44, all who believed were together. And verse 46, they spent much time together. Whatever their Christianity was like, it was a Christianity of togetherness, a real church community. Now, the Reformation rightly taught us that the prime duty and privilege of every human being was to place their own faith in Jesus, and so enjoy a personal relationship with God. And the Enlightenment wrongly taught us that religion is a private pursuit, not suited to the public square. But you add them up together, and you have a temptation I think we've inherited to think of Christianity as, at its heart, an individualistic thing. So now, hear me right, the Reformation was correct. Your first and most awesome blessing is that Jesus has reconciled you personally to God. It's beautiful, it's essential, but it's not all. Jesus has also reconciled us together to be God's people, to be his chosen holy community, together. It was never his plan that we be individual Christians alone in our faith. In fact, it's dangerous to try for too long. That's why the church is so important. Over time, the encouragement we get from meeting together, it boosts and supports, it sustains our individual relationship with God. And it creates something bigger than that. It creates a family, a people. All of us sent together to serve the world in love, called to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. And when it works well, it's a beautiful vision, isn't it? The description that we heard in Acts is mind-boggling. Theirs was a miraculous community, a radically generous community. It was a community which gathered together in public in the temple, and in private in their homes. And by God's good grace, it was a growing and fruitful community. It was beautiful. But I don't want you to lose sight of why they were like this. Because if we tried really, really hard to copy that outward form of their community without grasping the heart of their community, we would simply fail. And so let's remember the backstory in Acts chapter 2. Jesus had ascended to heaven and poured out his Holy Spirit on his disciples, filling them with his presence and power. and Peter had preached this message to all Jerusalem, that God had brought Jesus back to life, set him on heaven's throne, and the direct result of this was the gift of the Spirit to God's people. It's amazing, right? And even more amazing, today, through faith in Jesus, we too can receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is the key to being a real Christian community together. So if we keep in mind that they trusted in Jesus, full of his Spirit, I do think, though, that it's helpful to ask what it was that they actually did when they met together in public and private. And for that, we can turn to verse 42, which says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. They gave themselves to four things. Firstly, the apostles' teaching, or in other words, the gospel, the New Testament, and the Christian understanding of the whole Bible. It's mentioned first, I think, because it's fundamental to all that follows. Hearing the Word of God is the central act of our meeting together, because the Spirit of God uses the Word of God to inspire faith in his people, to illuminate their hearts and minds, and to form in them a mature Christian mindset. Second, we have fellowship. One of the most common ways of referring to Christians in the New Testament is brothers and sisters. And being with our spiritual family is crucial. Their friendship, their mutual support to us in life is invaluable, isn't it? And our companionship and service to them is a high calling for us, which shapes us into the people that Jesus wants us to be. Third, the prayers. And here I want you to have in mind the formal set prayers, like the Lord's Prayer or the formal confession we sometimes say together, as well as informal prayers, where we pour out our worries and concerns to God, praise him from the bottom of our hearts. Sung worship also falls into this category as well, because at its best, it's simply prayer put to music. And we know from elsewhere, don't we, that the early church loved to sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with glad hearts. Prayer is the heartbeat and the lifeblood of the Christian life. And four, the breaking of bread, otherwise known as the Lord's Supper or communion, which, along with baptism, as mentioned in verse 41, give us the two sacraments. These acts of worship are, if you like, kind of like acted out parables, signs and symbols like bread and wine, which remind us of the story of Jesus' great love and sacrifice for us, and which nourish us spiritually as they turn our hearts and minds to meditate on the blessings of the gospel and Jesus' presence with us. These four things are what theologians have called the means of grace, the things God most often uses to bless his people. Now, thankfully, God can do anything that he likes, and he can bless us any old way he likes. He's God. But Bible, fellowship, prayer, and the two sacraments are the normal ways in which our relationship with him flourishes. In other words, it's through making use of these gifts, that our attention is most commonly turned towards our Father, that we become like Jesus and are filled with God's love by his Holy Spirit. These activities are foundational for getting the heart of our Christian community right. But you might be asking, what am I trying to get at by reminding us of all of this stuff? Well, ultimately, you are responsible for your own relationship with God. Of course, not the institution of the church, not ministers, heaven knows, not priests. You alone are ultimately responsible before God for how you respond to him. And you alone are ultimately responsible for how you sustain the gift of faith that he's given you. But if we truly believed that these things were in fact the normal ways that God sustains our faith, these four things, if they were actually true, we might have a few responses to them, mightn't we? Firstly, as soon as it was safe to do so, we would meet for these reasons. Recently, we've had an example from those protesting about Black Lives Matter and about Extinction Rebellion. Without making any value judgment on the rightness of those gatherings, in fact, without making any political comment at all, here are people who believe that their cause is so fundamentally important that it's worth the risk to meet together publicly. So, Christian, do you believe that Jesus' cause is as fundamentally important as they believe theirs to be? Is God's glory and the spiritual health of your brothers and sisters worth the risk of gathering together in as safe a way as we possibly and feasibly can? Let me encourage you, as your garden group continues to find ways of meeting in person, join them if you can, if it's safe for you to do so. We're beginning to gradually reopen real world services in church, little by little, and only as we're confident that we can do so safely. So, over the next few months, when the type of service that you normally attend restarts, do come along and worship together. But, and this is important, let's be gentle with one another. Perhaps some of us really are chomping at the bit to get back, but perhaps others are cautious and concerned. So let each one make up their own mind for themselves, taking into account their own risk and their own situation, at peace before their Lord and with their own conscience. Secondly, if we truly believe that God blesses us through meeting together, we'd be aware that our own spiritual health may have suffered during lockdown. Perhaps our own relationship with God has taken a hit. Perhaps others in our church family have suffered in their relationship with God. So we'd be aware of our own weaknesses, patient with one another. Now, I think that actually we've done remarkably well as a church during lockdown. And I want to thank publicly all those who've given their time, their energy and their talents to these online services, to the digital life groups and the garden meetings, and of course to the various outreach activities which have still been going on. It's been remarkable and humbling to serve with you. I mean that truly. But if we're honest, as hard as we've tried, and as with as many late nights as we've had, and as much as God has blessed us through it all, these online services are no long-term substitute for meeting together in person, are they? We know that. We know. It's true. Maybe one of these services may have been more edifying for you than a particular real-world service that you remember. You may even sometimes have been bored during real-world services. It happens. I'm not denying that. But the truth is that the continued meeting together for fellowship, for Bible, prayer and communion, it restores our souls over time. It has a cumulative effect, like a dripping tap or the slow addition of layers of sand over millions and millions of years to make rock. Or perhaps with a more biblical image, keep on walking with the Lord, one foot after another after another. And thirdly, returning to my introduction, by gathering together like this, we can expect to be spiritually bolstered to cope with the rest of life and the joys and dangers of lockdown easing, with the financial or the relational difficulties it may have placed us in, or the mental and emotional strain of the last few months. or the concern and the anxieties we may have over potential second waves. The Lord himself provides what we need to face each and every situation with faith in his goodness and commitment to us. So let's draw close to him together. And finally, if we did meet for these reasons, surely we would expect God to bless us, wouldn't we? Listen, friends, God loves you. He is a generous-hearted God. He wants to give you gifts beyond measure, to pour out his grace into your life. He invites you close to him. Don't doubt it. Enjoy his love, because he loves you more than I could possibly describe. So when the particular service which you typically attend starts again, come along and worship. When your small group meets in a garden or elsewhere, do join if it's safe to do so, if you can. And in the meantime, let's continue to meet together for these online services. Continue to meet together on Zoom and other Skype and other things. And let's pray together. Let's read the Bible together. Let's share our lives in fellowship, and let's pray together. And God, who loves us, will bless us. Amen.
Be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I come to know the weaknesses I see in me.
Lord, how we thank you for the joy of worship, that we're able to enter into your courts with praise and enter your gates with thanksgiving. Oh, it's so good. Thank you, Lord. Now we cross right across the centre of Radcliffe on Trent to our correspondent in Lawn Grove, Julie Pierce, who's poised to interview me. Over to you, Julie.
Well, Mark, hello. It's lovely to see you this morning, as always. And I hear there's great news about things that are going to be changing on Sunday. And I don't know how you're feeling about that, going back into church for the services, and or how everybody else might be feeling. So perhaps you could just give us a little bit of information.
Well, thank you so much, Julie. It's good to see you as well. Yes, on Sunday, our early service, our 9 o'clock service, re-begins again in church. It's quite a leap of faith. There has been a huge amount of planning to make this possible. Our risk assessment is into double figures in terms of its pages and thinking through just about every single angle for this service. We're also going to be running a midweek service on Wednesday at 10 o'clock, and that's going to be held in the chancel and the chapel, but our early service on a Sunday will be in the nave as usual. It will look quite different. People will need to sit in designated places and be shown to their seats. Face masks will need to be worn. And we've simplified the church as much as possible so that we can accommodate people for this service. We have a seating limit of just over 30 or around the 30 mark. But we can overflow into the chancel and the chapel if necessary. How do I feel about it? Do you know, I'm excited. I've missed being with God's people physically on a Sunday. I've loved our online services. But there is something special about going into the building where God's people meet. I'm excited about it. I guess for others, how they feel, some will be very anxious, some won't feel that they can come. And all of those reactions are fine, because the most important thing is that we try to provide a safe environment for people to worship in. So perhaps I have some anxieties, yes, but I also have real excitement, because it will be the first occasion where physically we can come together as God's people.
Wow. Well, you know, your shared excitement is overflowing into lots of people's hearts and minds. And we would just really like to pray, because it's going to look different, isn't it? We're going to be together, but it's not going to be quite as it was. And it never will be as it was. So we're just going to ask God's blessing on that whole occasion, I think, and to rejoice that we can come back together as God's people.
May I
pray for you?
Of course you may.
Father, thank you that you have given us such a spirit of truth and love and long to worship you. And we ask now that you give us that great assurance of your presence, of your faithfulness, of your steadfast love, that you will lead us in safety. And Lord, we pray that overflowing love and worship will be a real presence in St. Mary's Church on Sunday morning. We come together as the body of Christ, and we just praise you and ask for your blessing upon Mark and all the people who will attend that service on Sunday and on Wednesday. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And you know, Julie, it might be helpful if I were able to say something about what we're hoping to do, what we're planning to do for our 10:30 service, our contemporary service.
Indeed.
As you know, we can't fit everybody into the church building, so we're going to be continuing with our online services. You know, frankly, they've been fantastic. Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. And we've discovered that the Holy Spirit is not affected by lockdown. God is with us. We're looking at investing in a little bit more technology,
so that we may be able to film some smaller services in church and put them online. We're even looking at whether we can live stream those services. So there's a lot of thinking, a lot of praying going on at the moment. How can we do it? But you know, one of the really exciting things that have been happening are the Zoom coffee times. It's been fantastic to just see people, talk together, sometimes share testimony of what God has been doing, and sometimes even reflecting on the service and the content of the sermon. It's been such a blessing to meet together. So long may that continue as we pray for God's blessing on his people, on his family here in Radcliffe-on-Trent. And to God be all the glory for all that's been achieved.
Hallelujah. And thank you, Mark, very much. We're just looking forward so much to being with you on Sunday and online as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Julie. The Lord bless you. And thank you for this moment. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Now we come towards the end of our service, and as we do so, we hear the words of the psalmist again, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases." I encourage you to use this and to reflect on the greatness of our God and his amazing love for each one of us. Then we shall move to prayer and to receiving God's blessing. And so now let us come to prayer. We pray for those who are ill or unwell. Gracious God, we thank you for your love shown to us in and through Jesus Christ. Surround those who are unwell, those who are struggling with life, with your amazing love. Grant them your peace, your presence, and your healing. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then a prayer for each and every one of God's people. Lord, we ask for your support. We ask for your help in our walk with you and in our daily life. We ask that you would equip us with more of your Holy Spirit that we may see more of the signs of your kingdom at work in our lives and in the life of our community and the places where we work. Send your Holy Spirit on your people, that we might be faithful witnesses to you in this generation, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And as Jesus taught us, so we pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And now we pray for God's amazing blessing to be upon his amazing family. May God, who is love, strengthen you with power from on high, and may God richly bless you with his blessing, the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. It really has been wonderful to be together this morning. Thank you to every single person who has shared in this service of worship. We think you are great. Now, if you're able, please do join us for Zoom coffee. You will find the link for this in Pew's News. It's an amazing opportunity to meet other people, to hear what God is doing, sometimes to pray together, and sometimes to reflect on the service. It really is good, and I encourage you, if you are able, to be there. So, if you can get there before me, I'll be smiling, but I'm off and I'm running. Bye!